Hey guys, so many of you guys have been having a lot of questions, and instead of just like answering each one specifically, I think it's best if we just have my friend, my mentor, my older brother Gary on this video, but after, of course, the intro. Anyways,
yeah, it's been a while. We've been out of commission.
Yeah, well, that I think that's what this video is talking about, because you know there's so much stuff that happened in the past couple weeks, and especially if you saw the previous video on what has been going on in like my life and Gary's life. This video is kind of like going to lay out what has happened in the past couple weeks so you could understand, and where we're probably going to take this in the next couple of months going on. But like for those that don't understand, man, it was like the previous video, I was like talking about how, you know, I kind of like felt lost, and I was like going out every single day, just kind of like losing sight of my vision and my purpose. And it was like crazy, because that's actually when you like texted me like what happened. And actually, do you want to like say your side of the story, what happened?
Wherever you were at the time, yeah. I mean, I text out like to a bunch of my friends and family members kind of what was going on in my life. So for those of you who are kind of like completely out of the loop here,
yeah.
A few months ago, Mike and I released and kind of like let the world know that we're doing this Mentored by Millionaires reality TV show here in Bali. And again, to just kind of like elaborate a little bit, we're going to be bringing people over to Bali, putting you up in a mansion and throwing a couple of our best mentors at you and teaching people how to make $1,000 a day or more. Mm-hmm. And the goal is to like help, you know, about a half a dozen people get to that breakthrough stage where, you know, just the world changes on a dime for you, and all of a sudden, you know, you're living the life of the, you know, the rich, and be able to travel around the world and do whatever the hell you want and have complete and total ultimate freedom. So that's been the plan. And Mike and I, you know, we came out and invited Mike's audience to come in and apply for this amazing reality TV show opportunity. At the time, we didn't really even know exactly what it was that
we just had a vision.
We were excited about it. It's something I've been thinking about for months. And then we're just like, let's just roll it out. We kind of went a little bit ahead of ourselves, you know. Mm-hmm. But so a lot of you probably been wondering like where things have gone since then. Why, you know, everything kind of went dark there for a while. There's actually a good reason for it. It's been a few months now, but so just to kind of like go deep into this, normally I don't like to talk about this kind of stuff because it's pretty personal, but I think we're all kind of family here when it comes to the reality TV show. I mean, you got to kind of know what's going on behind the scenes, right? So so what happened is like four months ago, I got dengue fever. Here in Bali, I didn't really know what to do because I didn't know what hospital to go to or anything, because I'd never been sick before, you know. Dengue fever is basically a mosquito bites you and infects you with some bacteria or something. And then you get the fever, and like for 5 or 6 days, you're basically horrible headache, you dizzy, and pretty severe fever, like 103 fever or something like that.
What was that like when you first getting like the symptoms? Because you didn't know it was dengue fever.
No, I just, you know, I went outside, I started to go to lunch, and I just felt, I mean, if you've ever had fever set on, like a high fever, you feel like your body just feels different. I mean, it's like not hot, not cold, it's just, but you know that something is happening. You're like, man, I just don't feel right, you know? And then it just progressively got worse. Then the headache came on. I went to the hospital here in Bali, and they checked my blood, and they identified it as, you know, probably being dengue fever, because a certain part of the blood, the red blood cells, white blood cells, something is in an identifier, because we're living in a tropical environment here. Dengue fever is a real thing. They don't have, what's the really bad one, like from Vietnam that they used to have, like,
I'm not sure.
Anybody know?
Like, I'm not. Look, you know, there's like, people around here watching too. you'll find out who there are. Like in a bit, it's gonna make sense.
People would get this horror. They get bit by a mosquito. And have this.
I'm thinking like, for some reason, yellow fever, but that's like something else.
It's like the really bad mosquito. Malaria. So malaria, they don't have that here in Bali. Yeah. Malaria is it's other areas, you know, of Asia maybe, but not really here. So anyway, dengue fever, it's pretty common here. I started asking my staff and people around, like, and about half the people have already had dengue fever. Mm-hmm. So it's not that uncommon. The problem is I went to the hospital, and the hospital, they were just incompetent. They didn't know what the hell they were doing. And, you know, one thing I say, if you travel Asia, make sure that you know which hospitals are good, because you never know what's going to happen. I was completely just blindsided by this. So I went to the wrong hospital, and they injected me with these IVs, and they were giving me the proper medications and stuff. They didn't have toilet paper there. They didn't have like cold packs, because I ended up with some swelling and stuff. So the injections end up giving me what's called cellulitis, which is a very even more dangerous infection than the dengue fever. Mm-hmm. And they didn't even identify it. You know, it took them like several days, and my arm, I got like the IV here, and then a red line started coming up my arm. Ooh. And then my arm started swelling, like huge swelling, and turning like this really dark red. I was like, what the hell's going on? You know, and the nurse is like, I think that's just normal for the IV.
I think that's just normal.
And finally we told the doctor, I was like, this is an infection. You can even feel it. It's hot, you know? And then I started having cold sweats. I think there were about 3 or 4 times there where everybody around me didn't think that I was going to pull through. They were like, dude, you got to fight. You got to like fight, man. Cause it's like, this up to you. You know, it's on you to like, you know, I felt like I was dying. I was 104 fever and just like convulsing, like this horrible shaking, you know, like violent, like shaking from like the chills, you know, and stuff. And then I would get this really hard, heavy onset fever after that. Anyway, it was worse than the dengue fever. So I had dengue fever followed up by cellulitis. And then they gave me another infection, like the food in the hospital also gave me another infection. The person who was there taking care of me, she ended up eating some of the hospital food, and she was out of commission for 24 hours.
Man.
Yeah, it was rough until I went to another hospital. Finally, I got out of there. I was like, I'm leaving this place. You know, even though I was like deathly ill, like got to get out of here. And I found a better hospital, did the research, found a good hospital. They immediately identified what was going on with my arms. And, you know, a few days later, I was like, I was back to normal. Mm. And then, you know, I thought I was out of the woods. I thought everything was great. In fact, I did fully recovered from that.
What was going on through your mind, though, like as it was getting worse and worse and worse?
Because
it was like dengue and then cellulitis. And then it's just like life just kicks you down one more time.
It was the first time I've ever been sick. I've never been in the hospital before. I've always been in good health. To be honest, I don't know if what it's like for other people going through a situation like this, but you just kick into survival mode and you try not to think and overthink, am I going to live or die, things like that. You just focus your energy on healing and doing what you need to do to get through the situation. Mm-hmm. You know, it's more like the anticipation that someday I'm going to get sick and die. That's more fearful than the actual going through it, because you're like, you know, I've just got to survive. And survival mode is a very powerful, you know, mental state to be in.
You forget about anything in your present situation that doesn't matter, right? Like all those little worries didn't matter.
They all will go away. Yeah. And I'm just like, I mean, when I was in the hospital, there was a 7.1 earthquake here.
Yeah.
And the walls were shaking.
Oh my God, it's like
people were screaming. I could hear it. There were things falling down around me. And still I was like, whatever. I'm already super. I'm already sick. I'm just staying in bed, man.
Yeah.
Like everybody else can run outside and hide or whatever. But so anyway, I pulled through that, and you know, I had the support group around me, and it was great and everything. I kind of kept a lot of that to myself. I didn't really talk a whole lot about that, but I think I may have said something on my YouTube channel or Facebook or something. A couple months go by. And then I won't give you the gory details, but I had a symptom. I went out to lunch. And then I just noticed a symptom in my body. I went to the hospital to check it out, and they said, it looks like, they checked my blood and they said, there's definitely something going on here. Your red blood count is like through the roof. And then they did some other kind of like scan on me, you know, like ultrasound to see how my kidney was doing. And they said there was a slight swelling in my kidney, but it's probably an infection. Go ahead and go home, take these antibiotics. And I'm like, after the last experience that I had with the hospitals, I'm like, I don't trust Bali hospitals.
Yeah.
I'm just going to Singapore. Singapore in Asia has the best medical. It's pretty much equivalent to the US standards. It's amazing. They have really great medical. It's about 5 times cheaper than in America, but it's also way more expensive than here in Bali, but way better quality care. So went there. Did a CT scan because based on my symptoms, they thought that it might be cancer or some kind of, or hopefully something else, you know, some kind of like random thing like an infection, or maybe the medication that I'd taken during my dengue fever had caused some, you know, like blood in my urine or something like that. And they didn't find anything. So the CT scan came out great, and I was like, whew. And they were like, if since you're here, if you want to, we can do a cystoscopy, I think it's called, where they go inside of your bladder with a camera and look around and make sure that there's no tumor or anything like that in there. So they went up. I was like, yeah, since I'm here, I might as well. He's like, otherwise, it's probably like less than a 1% chance that we'll find anything. And I was like, okay, you know, so I did it, went up inside, and I was awake during the whole thing, and you could see the circular camera, and he's showing me, he's like, yeah, we turn over here and look down, you know, and like the lining of your bladder looks great, everything looks really looks good. Like up over here, there's these two holes you can see, this is your ureter, you know, this is where the urine flows out of your kidney into your bladder. Over here, there's another one you can see, those look great. And then all of a sudden, these little tentacles said, and they came out of this hole. And I was like, what? And he's like, whoa. And I said, what the f- is that? I was shocked. And I was like, I looked like, I swear to God, it looked like an alien.
Inside
it looked
you?
Like a sand crab come out of a hole on the bottom of the ocean and just moving his little legs around. But it looked like an alien. And he didn't tell me what it was for a while. So like 5 seconds, it felt like 5 minutes. I was just like, what the fuck is that? I thought that there was an alien crawling in. And, you know, the bladder is small and the ureter hole is tiny.
Yeah.
But on the camera, it looked big.
Huge,
it
yeah.
looked like there was a little creature crawling through my bladder and through the holes. And I was like, it was hiding up inside of there, you know?
It's so freaking weird.
And he's like, no, it's a tumor. And I was like, thank God it's only a tumor. I thought it was an alien. You know, things could be worse. So it turned out to be a tumor. And so that's the bad news. And so I kind of panicked when I thought it was an alien. And then when it turned out to be a tumor, I calmed back down. My heart, you can hear your heart.
Yeah.
It goes, beep, 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 beep. And then it goes, beep, 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 beep. Thank God it's only a tumor. We get out of there and he's like, so it is a tumor. So we need to do a biopsy. We need to go up inside and go up into the ureter this time. And you're going to have to be knocked out. So they decide to do that. And you know, I was really worried at that point because I never had surgery or anything, never been under anesthesia. You know, there's certain risks with anesthesia. For anybody out there who's worried about anesthesia, it's only like 1 in 200,000 chance of somebody dying under anesthesia.
Yeah.
So I learned all this stuff, you know, just doing the research. But so they went up in there and they found that the thing with the finger sticking out was actually a very small tumor right up inside of my ureter. The good news is that the tumor is like this long, you know, just long tentacles. And I mean, short, but long, yeah. skinny tentacles. And they barely reached just to come outside of that ureter opening. And had they been like this much shorter, we would never have seen it. Because we were not going to go up into the ureter when I'm awake, you know. So he said that had we not seen that, he would have just sent me home. I would have came back to Bali. And then 6 to 12 months later, I would have been coming back to Bali or coming back to Singapore again with the repeat symptoms. And then it would have been too late, you know?
Yeah.
So yeah, they went up in there and they removed the major part of the tumor. And then they did a biopsy on it and they found that it was like low grade stage 1 cancer. And they said that we need to go in and actually remove a portion of your ureter. So we went in for another procedure recently. This was only like 3 weeks ago. We went in for another procedure and actually they did robotic surgery where there's these arms, these prongs go down inside of your stomach in 6 different openings. And he's using virtual reality with joysticks and stuff for 7 hours to cut out a portion of a small portion of the bottom of my ureter. And then they do some crazy stuff. I mean, they do some really high tech stuff to like fix me up.
Yeah,
I'll put it like that.
Yeah.
And so 7 hours later, I right now the wounds on my stomach are almost completely healed, even though it's been 3 weeks. So robotic surgery is amazing. As of right now, I'm cancer free. Knock on wood. For all we know, I'm cancer free. I have a new lease on life. And, you know, I do have to go back every 3 or 4 months and get a checkup, you know, and they'll go back inside and make sure that there's no recurrence. But the chance of a recurrence is about 30% in my lifetime in my bladder. And it's less than that in my kidneys or anywhere else in my body. So first year is the most dangerous, high risk.
Yeah,
and that's,
yeah.
This is just where I'm at. You know, I mean, I kind of want to keep this private, but at the same time, you know, I've realized through this situation that there's a lot of people out there that, you know, that care, that send their sentiments. And I think it kind of lifts me up. I feel like I want to be closer knit to people. I want to kind of put myself into the community and feel even more connected with the people around me. Mm-hmm. You know, and I've learned a lot through the situation. Let me tell you, you know, you don't go through a really difficult challenge in life without learning something, without changing. And I think that sometimes the challenges get harder and harder because you climb that mountain and you get to the point where you need bigger challenges in order to overcome bigger obstacles, you know, in life. And if you want to do bigger and bigger and better things, it's like you need to be pushed and challenged even further and further. And for anybody out there who might feel sorry for me over this, don't. You know, I don't feel sorry for myself. I don't feel afraid. I don't feel anxiety or anxiousness or panic or anything like that. I'm not sitting around worrying about myself or feeling sorry for myself. I look at it as like an amazing opportunity to push myself even further and to be even more driven, because, you know, it's just another you know, it's just another one of those cases where you realize that your life, you know, you're only here for a short time, and you got only one chance to do something amazing with your life. And that's what I'm here to do. I'm going to do something amazing. And we've already had plans to do amazing shit, and it's just going to get better and better and better. But now, you know, I'm going to come after it with even more drive, you know, and more force, because it's more important to me. You know, I mean, I have had the chance now over the last 3 or 4 months because of the dengue fever and the cellulitis, and now with, you know, like the worst news you could imagine, you know, cancer. And by the way, I'm also surrounded by an amazing support group. I have a really good friend who's gone through and beat cancer, who's been like my mentor, my health coach through this thing. And he's just super knowledgeable. I know the guys from The Truth About Cancer, which is a really popular thing if you want to research it. I've been connected with those guys, and there's a lot of scientists and doctors behind that entire production. And I'm connected with those guys now. And I have it together. It's like, I know I have a protocol. I have like a plan of action. And I'm going to be pushing myself to the best health imaginable. Even right now, I'm at the lowest weight that I've been, not because of cancer either, from dieting, from doing like the protocol. You know, it's like, I feel great. I have a lot of energy. Everything is great.
Yeah, dude. It's crazy, because like, I've been hanging out with him for the past couple of days, because like, he just got here, and I was like, Gary, and I gave him like a freaking hug, because like, seriously, it's like, we're family. Yeah. And it was just insane, because not only did he get out of surgery, and he has like this thing attached to his like leg. What is that?
It's a catheter, man.
How does that work?
It's like a tube sticking up my pee hole.
Okay, and it's like in your blood?
And then you don't have to urinate. You know, because I mean, they did surgery on my bladder. Yeah. They cut a portion of my bladder out and folded it up and wrapped it around to form like a new part of my ureter, you know? So it's a pretty, quite traumatic and pretty, you know, elaborate surgery that they did. So just to like alleviate any stress on my bladder, so they're not stretching my bladder, they put a catheter in there.
It's like a balloon, and then
it's a tube that goes up inside. Then they blow a little balloon up inside there to hold it in, so it doesn't come out. But then the urine just flows out into a bag, and then you gotta drain it.
It's insane.
It's weird.
He got it like literally just recently, and then I'm already here hanging out, and he's already like driving a car, and he's like lifting stuff, and he's like walking upstairs. I'm like, yo, you chilling? Yeah. He's like, no, actually, like, this is really good in some parts, especially if you're like in a relationship, which we can't go much into that. Like,
do your own research. Weird.
But what I think, it's just amazing the perception that you see the world, or your lens that you see the world. Because whenever someone gets negative news, you know, they beat themselves up, and it's that negativity that almost turns their body into that acidic environment that actually makes the disease worse, the cancer worse, and stuff like that. And what's crazy is for you is like, you always saw like the cup half full instead of half empty. And even like when he was telling me the story, like I came and I was like, man, I feel like really bad. Like, what can I do to help? But the stories you were telling me, even you getting through airport security with that, because it looks like you're trying to like sneak in.
Give me that bag. I'm like, no, you give me that bag. Yeah, like, it's attached.
It's attached to, you know, is a thing.
Yeah. But and Rob over here, he was like saying, you want like to borrow a designer bag or something for that? And I'm like, somebody's gonna like snatch it and run away with it and take my
penis
away with them.
Oh, man. Like, yeah.
I'll stick with the Grand Hyatt, you know.
Like, yeah, it literally looks like he's walking around like he's he has like
a sports bag or something.
Sports bag, but you'll see like a straw. It looks like a straw.
Yeah.
So it looks like you're trying to sneak alcohol through like TSA or something
into
like
the,
that.
Into the movie theater.
Yeah. But that's the craziest thing, guys. It's like we just wanted to let you guys know what's going on, right? Because we have some big plans, some of the biggest projects that we have. We even have like some surprise guests where you don't even know who this guy is.
But if you've
seen some of the videos, you kind of know who he is. We brought him here, but like we'll maybe make another video to do that. But we're just super excited because it's just like what's going on with him is just a testimony to you guys. Where if he's able to get through that, to come back here and to take action on his goals, then what's stopping you, right? What's stopping you from getting to that next best version of yourself, to living that life that you want, of doing all the things that you've ever wanted in terms of income, of lifestyle and contribution in your life? And that's kind of like what I want you guys to take from this, is because I want you to not only look at this day as like a day of like, oh, Gary got better, but almost like a day, you were almost like reborn, man. When I saw you, like, you looked healthier. You had like actual like blush in your skin, and then your motivation and just your drive and just your vision has been so insane, so inspirational, like for me, man. And I'm just super excited to see what's gonna happen from this.
Yeah, and I think that's a good point, you know, to touch on a little bit more is just that, you know, everybody has challenges in life. And when you're younger, I mean, if you think about it like a child, they're on the playground and like, Tommy won't talk to me, and that's their biggest problem in the world.
Yeah.
And that's a challenge that they have to go through to overcome so that they can grow. And then as you go through life, your challenges tend to grow with you. And as long as you carry the attitude with you that a challenge is more like an opportunity to change and better yourself.
Yeah.
A challenge is a fuel that you can use to get refocused, to change your direction, to stop being lazy, to stop getting, you know, falling out of your zone, and to get back in it and say, I gotta work here because, you know, I gotta overcome. Truthfully, every time I have a challenge, including, I didn't realize that it was even gonna, you know, carry me through like, you know, cancer news of having the big C, you know?
Yeah.
I didn't realize it, but that attitude has carried with me through every single challenge. And no matter what challenge you come across in your life, you can definitely leverage that feeling that you have, I mean, that understanding, that knowledge, that wisdom or that insight to know that every challenge is just an opportunity to improve yourself.
Yeah.
And you look at it like it's almost like a gift.
Yeah.
It's a gift that you're given.
Disguised as a curse,
depending on how you look at it and your attitude. But I mean, like if you're in a video game, it's like you just level up, you know, you're given something like
you grow to the size of the obstacle that is in front of you. But like what I'm curious on, because like everything about you is just so crazy. It's like moving forward and it's so amazing to see. But like when someone says cancer, and especially because like some of my family members had cancer, there's always like that split second or that moment of like fear, of uncertainty, of like your own mortality. Like,
right.
Did you have like any flashes in your mind on what you would have regretted not doing once that clarity was right in front of you?
Yes, actually.
What was your biggest regret?
I would say I wouldn't frame it like a regret, like I didn't have some regrets, but I felt like more like a shifting or a refocusing of what I should do going forward. I don't have the negative like life is over.
Yeah.
I have a positive like from here forward, I'm going to change a few things. And a few things I think, you know, that I need to change, that I want to change, is my children. I want to spend more time with my kids. You know, I'm flying back there in a few weeks to go spend Christmas and New Year's with my kids. That's really important to me because it's one of the things in my life where I feel like, you know, it's like I want to give them more of myself, you know?
Mm-hmm.
And believe it or not, even though I try to pour myself completely into my students, I still feel like I can give them more. Somehow I can give them more. Like I want to leave my mark on the world. I want to be remembered. You know, people want to be remembered. So you want to do something great, epic, amazing, that people will cry when you're gone, or at least feel sad that you're gone, you know, and it's like, I feel like I can do more for people, you know, I feel like I can work harder. I don't, you know, sometimes I'm going to get a massage when I could be like utilizing my mind to like pour myself deeper into what it is that my mission, you know, my vision. I thought about like, what is my vision, you know, what is my purpose, you know, like what is my big contribution to the world, and am I doing everything that I can, you know? And it's good to ask yourself that question often, because sometimes what it is that you're doing can shift and change, you know, based on where you're at in the world, you know. And you know, of course I'm like, okay, it's time to cure cancer now, you know.
Yeah. You killed it with your brain.
Actually, I do have some ideas, you know. But anyway, so that's it. I mean, we could go down this tunnel forever.
Yeah, we could go for hours, man, especially like what we're talking about. But
the important thing is like how this affects you. And everything has come together right now. So like, again, the people that are all standing around us, this is the first time our video crew and everybody has come together for the first time. Mr. Hollywood producer.
Damn, Rob.
Rob's
look,
here.
He's getting swole, man.
Yeah, man.
The
Rob's
alpha
been working out.
Lifestyle.
That's right.
Yeah.
And so we're getting ready to have a big meeting over here, and then we'll tell you more about that. But
in the next video. In the next video.
In the next video.
You'll find out who the hell this guy is in the next video.
And things are going to get really exciting from here forward.
Just wave, Jason. And then say outro.